Hello! There wasn't going to be a film for this little project. It adds a good long time to whatever I'm making, and I just wanted to crack on with it and get it finished. But when I look back over the stills and the odd video clip that I'd taken on my phone, I figured I had enough material for a quick overview, in case anyone else wanted to do something similar. I had two issues. First, the graduated dial on the metric cross slide has 40 divisions of 0.025mm, which means just about every cut that I take needs a calculator to figure out how many divisions are needed to get down to a particular size. I won some graduated rings on eBay years ago, but I've only just got round to using them. These have 100 divisions, which conveniently equate to 0.01mm per line on my 1mm pitch lead screw. I'm well aware that expecting less than half a thou accuracy on a mini lathe is pushing my luck, but at least I can do the numbers in my head. The figures will be upside down in use, but I can cope with that. To reduce the bulk, I removed the knurl section and added grooves on each edge to take O-rings that would provide friction drag when the outer is rotated. The 2BA threaded hole wasn't any use to me, so I silver soldered it up and dressed it back. Using a fairly sketchy arbor, I turned up a couple of brass end cap washers and made a center core from Delrin that I can lock to the shaft with a grub screw. With the center, washers and ring assembled and a drop of silicon grease, the action's nice and smooth. The second issue is there's very little in the way of bushes and bearings on the entire machine. Most things are a fairly sloppy metal to metal fit and a bit prone to galling up in use. I've previously added miniature thrust races to the tailstock and compound slides for the same reason. For the cross slide, the thrust would be taken by a pair of 6700 thin section bearings. Now these only have a very minimal axial load rating, but they cost pennies and will take seconds to replace. And more importantly, they fit within the limited real estate on the edge of the cross slide. As I was going to the trouble of stripping the thing down, I decided to increase the cross slide travel too. By milling out some of the spare meat in the saddle, I'm able to move the cross slide back an extra 15mm. In order for that to work, the lead screw boss needs to be made longer by the same amount, so I made a new one from aluminium. The longer boss meant the lead screw barely poked out at the end, so I made an extension sleeve to fit. I anodized and dyed the boss black, for no better reason than I fancied having a white line instead of a black one. Here's the new and the old. There's a recess in the end to take a 6900 bearing to support the extended lead screw at the handle end. Finally, I bored out the handle to tap end 10 by 0.75 so it would securely fasten onto the extension. And I made a brass lock nut to hold it in place. With the old setup, the cross slide would move back so the compound was about level with the edge of the chuck. Depending on the tool and the size of the job, this setup can be a bit restrictive. The oddball imperial metric graduated dial was prone to jamming between the cross slide and the handle, losing its setting. With the new setup, the graduated wheel reads sensible metric measurements and is independent of the parts surrounding it, so it should never jam up. The extra movement of the cross slide means I can get a tool onto a part up to 30mm bigger in diameter. So far, so good. But there are a couple of other things that I wanted to address. I've never been happy with the gib strip. It's much smaller than the slot that it sits in. And rather than sitting parallel against the dovetail, it's prone to rolling over and jamming when it's tightened. Plus it's about as straight as a banana. As a proof of concept, I made a larger replacement from brass. I used a superglue arbor and took very light cuts so that it wouldn't break away. When my arm got tired after the first few passes, I switched to the power feed. Leaving the part in a plastic bag with a splash of acetone for a couple of hours released the gib from the support. It's not perfect, but I'm happy with it for Mark 1. I know the method works now, so I can always make another when the time comes. This is a long way from hand-scraped perfection, but I'll take small improvements where I can get them. The last job was to make an oiler for the cross-slide nut. The nut is simply hung from two cap-head screws that are adjusted for a position that allows full travel of the slide with no binding, and then the pressure from a central grub screw locks it in place. By introducing a small amount of tilt by having one screw tighter than the other, backlash can be minimised. The nut is drilled right through to the lead screw, so I reckoned I could use it as a lubrication point. I was going to replace one of the cap heads with a drilled oiling screw, and you might think, given that I've got a tailstock die holder and a rotary brooch on hand, I'd be able to make a screw from scratch. But I took a different, lazier approach. I took an M6 cap head and an M4 cap head, and silver soldered the top of one to the bottom of the other. That way I'd have a bigger cup to aim for to get the oil into, and then drilled a 2mm hole right the way through. With the screw removed, you can see the threads of the lead screw down the hole. Finally, I made a push-fit brass cap to keep swarf out of the hole. It definitely feels better to use, so I think it was worth the effort. I hope there's some ideas in there for other mini lathe users. And that's pretty much it for this one. Thanks for watching.